गुड मॉर्निंग. सो द सेकेंड क्लास इन द सिस्टम GIT पेप्टिक अल्सर डिसीज. लास्ट क्लास में कोई क्वेरी? इज द सेम सेवन क्लासेस एंड प्लान विल रिमेन सेम इन फॉर द पॉइंट्स इटियोलॉजी पैथोजेनेसिस पैथोलॉजी एंड इन दिस चैप्टर माइक्रोबायोलॉजी इज इंपॉर्टेंट जस्ट बिकॉज ऑफ एच पायलोराई. दिस इज द सेम पिक्चर. नाउ वी हैव कम टू द सेकेंड पार्ट दिस वन. सो टूडे द मेन we will concentrate on gastric type secretory mucosa. This is the anatomy of stomach. Stomach starts when the esophagus ends and the stomach ends into duodenum. Why it is important? Because in peptic ulcer disease the acid is more in the stomach, so it can regurgitate to the esophagus causing which disease? In the esophagus due to acidity? GERD, resulting into Barrett's esophagus. What is Barrett's esophagus? Yes, please, anyone? Aap bataye. Change okay. कॉलिमनर हो जाता है. ठीक है. एंड सिमिलरली एट द लोअर एंड वी गेट द अल्सर्स इन स्टमक एंड साइमल्टेनियसली वी मे गेट द अल्सर्स इन ड्यूडिनम ऑल्सो एंड कलेक्टिवली दे आर नोन एज पेप्टिक अल्सर डिसीज. ड्यूडिनल अल्सर एंड गैस्ट्रिक अल्सर बोथ. इन बिटवीन द पार्ट इज कॉल्ड बॉडी ऑफ द स्टमक वे आर मोस्ट ऑफ द एसिड सिक्रेशन टेक्स प्लेस. So this is histology in the non-distended form. We can see the rugosities. And these are gastric pits. The enlarged form of gastric pit we will see in the next slide. And below this is muscle layer having three layers of muscles: oblique, सर्कुलर एंड लॉन्जिट्यूडनल. दिस इज द गैस्ट्रिक ग्लैंड. इनिशियली वी सॉ द गैस्ट्रिक पिट फ्रॉम वेयर ऑल द सीक्रेशन कम आउट एंड दिस पिट इज कनेक्टेड टू अराउंड 1 to 7 गैस्ट्रिक ग्लैंड. दीज आर गैस्ट्रिक ग्लैंड हैविंग द लाइनिंग ऑफ डिफरेंट काइंड ऑफ सेल्स. इन द नेक रीजन देयर आर मेनली म्यूकस सेल्स and in the lower region there are enzyme secreting and acid secreting cells. So neck mucus cells are of two types: surface mucus cell and neck mucus cells. Surface mucus cells cover the luminal surface of the stomach and partly line the gastric pit. These cells have short surface microvilli and secrete protective bicarbonate ions directly into the deeper layers of the surface mucus coat. This is important. Mucus coat. This mucus coat covers whole of the stomach and it gives a protective layer against acid, which has a pH of 1 to 4, highly acidic. Okay. And simultaneously bicarbonates are being secreted in this layer to neutralize that acid. So this layer, mucus layer, forms a protective layer. Then neck mucus cells are squeezed between the parietal cell in the neck and base of the gastric glands. These cells have larger secretory granules and more polyribosomes than surface mucus cells. So these are the mucus cells. You can see the mucus in the cells, and these cells are the parietal cells. Okay. Why this color is eosinophilic of these cells. What may be the reason? Because they are having a lot of mitochondria. Lot of mitochondria. Because acid secretion needs energy, ATPase, which is coming from mitochondria. Okay? So these parietal cells are full of mitochondria. Parietal or oxyntic cells, they are also known as oxyntic cells, are distributed along the length of the gland but tend to be most numerous in the isthmus of the gland. These large rounded cells have an extensive eosinophilic or oxyntic cytoplasm and a centrally located nucleus. Parietal cells secrete gastric acid as well as intrinsic factor. What is intrinsic factor? Glycoprotein necessary for the absorption of vitamin B12 in the terminal ileum. Why this line is important nowadays for morbid obesity? Surgeons are doing gastrectomy, partial gastrectomy. Okay? So because of that gastrectomy, this intrinsic factor is lost. Body doesn't get this intrinsic factor. And just because of the lack of this intrinsic factor, B12 is not absorbed. Okay, so the persons who are having gastrectomy due to morbid obesity are having the deficiency of vitamin B12 just because of the deficiency of intrinsic factor, which has been lost during gastrectomy. Next is chief peptic or zymogenic cells. These are located towards the bases of the gastric glands. Peptic cells are recognized by their condensed basally located nuclei and strongly basophilic granular cytoplasm. This basophilic cytoplasm is due to the presence of ribosomes. And these are the pepsin secreting cells. Pepsin is an enzyme released in the form of pepsinogen, gets converted into pepsin with the help of acid and helps in the digestion of proteins. Okay? We are going a little back just because this is the area of parietal cells, then mucous cells, here peptic cells, parietal cells, this is the structure of gland, gastric gland. Here we can see these are parietal cells, eosinophilic cytoplasm, and these are chief cells, basophilic cytoplasm. Okay? And these are endocrine cells, this one. So which hormone is released from stomach? Gastrin. Very nice. Neuroendocrine cells, part of the diffuse neuroendocrine system, are also found in the base of the gastric gland. They secrete 5-HT serotonin and other hormones. Stem cells are used for regeneration, are found mainly in the neck of the gastric gland. These undifferentiated cells divide continuously to replace all other types of cells in the gland. The maturing cells then migrate up or down wherever required, and these cells are not easily identified in sections of the normal gastric mucosa but become very prominent with plentiful mitotic figures after damage to the mucosa for the regeneration purpose. So these are the location of the cells depending on the part of the stomach. In the cardia, we get mostly mucus and the endocrine cells. In the body, most of the cells are there. Mucus cells, parietal cell, chief cell, endocrine cell, enterochromaffin and enterochromaffin-like cells. In the pyloric antrum, mucosal and the endocrine cells. So the rough diagram. What are the factor which can damage the gastric mucosa? It is the gastric acidity with a low pH, very low pH, and the peptic enzymes. For this, we have different layers of protection. In the pre-epithelial form, we have a mucus layer, which is full of bicarbonates and phospholipids. Then the epithelial layer. In the sub-epithelial layer, we get the microvascular system, which is used for washing up the extra acidity or extra foreign materials. So these are the three layers of protection in the stomach. What is PUD, peptic ulcer disease? It is defined as disruption of the mucosal integrity. It can be present in stomach or duodenum, where the diameter of the lesion is more than 5 mm and depth is up to submucosa. There is a local defect or extra cavation due to the inflammation. What can be the etiology of peptic ulcer disease? A long list. On the top is H. pylori, Helicobacter pylori. Then NSAIDs. What is NSAIDs? Non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. You will see in the next slide how they work in this etiology. Then drugs may cocaine, which reduces mucosal blood flow, which was being used as a protective factor. COPD, CRF, tobacco use, recent or the past one, old age, coronary heart disease, past alcohol use, African or American race, obesity, diabetes, psychological stress, endocrine cell hyperplasia, which can stimulate parietal cell growth and gastric acid secretions. Then Zollinger-Ellison syndrome, viral infections like CMV and herpes simplex. So these are etiology. We have to write in the exam when we'll get this question. Etiology, pathogenesis, pathology. This is one of that slide. Then what is the difference between duodenal and gastric ulcer? The first column is for duodenal ulcer. Duodenal ulcer is mostly due to H. pylori, located mostly in D1 part, that is within 3 cm of the pylorus. The size is less than 1 cm. They are sharply demarcated and they invade up to muscularis propria. Base shows eosinophilic necrosis. While gastric ulcers, they can represent malignancy, so they are more alarming. So whenever we get a gastric ulcer, we have to take a biopsy of that ulcer, because that may be malignant ulcer. This is mostly distal to the junction of enterum and acid secreting mucosa, associated with H. pylori, which may cause enteral gastritis, later converting into the peptic ulcer disease. NSAIDs, chemical gastropathy, pathology is foveolar hyperplasia, lamina propria edema, and epithelial regeneration. So we have studied this much part. Now the injury. What can cause H. pylori, NSAIDs, tobacco, alcohol, gastric hyperacidity, and duodenal gastrical reflex? We can divide these factors into two parts, endogenous factors and exogenous factors. So HCl, pepsinogen, and bile salts are the endogenous factor which may cause peptic ulcer. And exogenous factors are medications, alcohol, and bacteria. So the third part is the result of these factors which may cause the ulcer. So ulcer base is having necrotic debris. We can draw this diagram also in peptic ulcer. Necrotic debris, non-specific acute inflammation, granulation tissue and fibrosis. These are the contents of ulcer, ulcer bed. Now, how a NSAID causes peptic ulcer? NSAIDs works due to inhibition of cyclooxygenase. It's an enzyme. We'll see the figure first. Phospholipids get converted into arachidonic acid by the action of phospholipase. Then, this arachidonic acid, with the help of either COX-1 or COX-2, gets changes into prostacyclins. Okay, so COX-1 is an enzyme which is present in stomach, kidney, platelets and endothelial cells. So this is important in our case, PUD, COX-1. And COX-2 is generated only in the cases of inflammation, where macrophages, leukocytes, fibroblasts, and synovial cells. So this enzyme is generated in the cases of inflammation, causing pain, heat, swelling. And this COX-1 causes housekeeping functions like platelet regulation, kidney function, regulation of the stomach acid and mucus production. Okay, so the COX-1 is protective. So when we take NSAIDs, this COX-1 is inhibited, causing breach in the protective activity. So that's why we say don't take NSAIDs frequently. Okay. So NSAIDs inhibit COX-dependent synthesis of prostaglandins E2 and I2, which contribute to nearly all of the above defense mechanism, including mucus, bicarbonate, phospholipid secretion, mucosal blood flow, and epithelial restitution. They also reduce acid secretion, but in lesser amount. Although COX-1 plays a larger role than COX-2, both isoenzymes contribute to the mucosal protection. So thus, while risk of NSAIDs-induced gastric injury is greatest with the non-selective inhibitors, which inhibit both COX-1 and COX-2. But still, if we take the selective COX-2 inhibitor like naproxen, still there is chance of gastropathy or gastritis. Next cause etiology is H. pylori, Helicobacter pylori. So it's a spiral-shaped or curved bacilli. It stays in mucus layer only. And the main thing is that this bacteria is not causing any injury. Injury in the form of damage of the epithelium. It's not causing any damage. Major cause of gastritis and peptic ulceration is H. pylori. The organism does not invade the tissue, but inhibits the protective mucus layer, which covers the surface of the mucosa. It has a unique ability to survive the acid environment of the stomach because of the bacterial enzyme urease. We use this enzyme as a diagnostic tool also, urease enzyme. This allowed it to produce ammonia by splitting urea and in turn causing raise in the pH in the immediate vicinity of the organism. It typically colonizes the enterum by producing a localized alkaline environment. So what will this cause? Alkaline environment? This will send signal to the stomach more. The environment is alkaline. So you need to produce acid more. Okay, so it is that indirect cause of ulceration. H. pylori interferes with the normal physiological control of gastric acid secretion. The falsely high enteral pH stimulates secretion of gastrin by enteral G cells, which acts upon the parietal cells in the body to increase the acid production still further. This excess acid production overwhelms normal mucosal defense mechanism, leading to the formation of the acute ulcer. So the main thing in this is H. pylori directly is not causing ulcer. It is the indirect cause of peptic ulcer by increasing the pH and sending the signal to the hormone to produce more acid. Okay? So now about H. pylori. H. pylori organism have adapted to the ecological niche of the gastric mucosa. Its virulence is linked to the following factors. Number one, flagella, which allows the bacteria to be motile in viscous mucus. Urease, which generates ammonia. Adhesins, which enhances bacterial adherence. And toxins, like cytotoxin-associated gene A. So these are all comma-shaped bacilli here. These are all H. pylori. As we can see, these are only on the surface, not inside the cell. Okay? And the stain for this is Worthen Sterry silver stain. This is another top question for H. pylori. What is the stain used to highlight these organisms? Worthen starry silver stain. And due to this, we get the neutrophilic infiltration in the lamina propria, submucosal layer. There are multiple neutrophils. And formation of lymphoid aggregate. This is the gross picture of H. pylori. What can be seen through this picture? What you can comment on this? The mucosa is in the level. This is most important point. Mucosa is in the level of the stomach layer. It is not everted. When it gets everted, then there are chances of malignancy. So in gastric ulcer disease, the mucosa is depressed. So there is a crater sort of formation. And in this crater, we can find the inflammatory cells. Pathogenesis. Peptic ulcer disease results from imbalance between defense mechanism and damaging factor that cause chronic gastritis. Thus, peptic ulcer disease generally develops on a background of chronic gastritis. The reasons why some people develop only chronic gastritis while others develop PUD is poorly understood. However, as with H. pylori gastritis, it is likely that host factors as well as variation in the pathogenicity of the bacterial strains are involved. Now the clinical features. Another heading in the question, clinical features of peptic ulcer disease. First one is epigastric pain. And what are the features of these pain? Pain increases due to fasting and relieved by meal or alkali. Alkali in the form of, we take the antacids, liquid antacids. Okay. So that pain is relieved by taking alkali or meal. It is 1 to 3 hours after meals during the day. It is worse at night, usually between 11 p.m. to 2 a.m. Sometimes we get the penetrating ulcer pain, occasionally referred to the back, left upper quadrant or chest, which may be confused with cardiac pain. Next is iron deficiency anemia in the clinical features. Hemorrhage, perforation, nausea, vomiting, bloating, belching, and significant weight loss. These are the microscopic features of the peptic ulcer biopsy. We mostly get the chronic gastritis. We have discussed foveolar hypermetaplasia in which gastric type mucus cells are present. In common in chronic dependent in chronic duodenal peptic disease and may be protective response as gastric epithelia are less sensitive to acid than intestinal epithelia. Gastric peptic ulcers are predominantly located along the lesser curvature near the interface of the body and enterum. Why this is important? During endoscopy, we look these areas more prominently. Peptic ulcers are solitary in more than 80% of the patient and form a round to oval, sharply punched out defect. In mucosal, the mucosal margin is usually level with the surrounding mucosa, but may overhang the base, particularly on the proximal side. As I told you earlier also, in contrast, heaped up margin are more characteristic of the cancers. The depth of the ulcer correlates with the diameter and deep extension may be limited by the thick gastric muscularis propria, adherent pancreas, omental fat or the liver. Perforation may take place if it goes deeper into the peritoneal cavity, which is a surgical emergency. That may be identified as a free ear under the diaphragm on upright abdominal radiograph. The base of the peptic ulcer is smooth and clean as a result of peptic digestion of the exudate. Active ulcers may be lined by thin layers of fibrinoid debris with a predominantly neutrophilic infiltration, which we saw in the figure. Beneath these, granulation tissue with immature vessels, mononuclear leukocytes, and a fibrous or collagenous scar forms under the ulcer base. Larger vessels within the scarred area are typically thickened and are occasionally thrombosed. Bleeding may take place through these vessels, causing hemorrhage. scarring may involve the entire thickness of the wall and draw the surrounding mucosa into the folds that radiate outward. Treatment line: antibiotics for H. pylori, proton pump inhibitors to decrease the acid environment, and withdrawal of other offending agents like NSAIDs, including COX-2 inhibitors. What can be the complications for this peptic ulcer? Bleeding in 50 to 20% of the patient. It is the most frequent complication, important thing. Most frequent complication of gastric ulcer or peptic ulcer disease is bleeding. It can be microscopic also, leading to small quantity of blood loss from the ulcer, resulting into iron deficiency anemia. We investigate all the reasons, but we don't do the endoscopy from where the blood is oozing. Okay. Maybe life-threatening. Accounts from 25% of the ulcer-related deaths may be the first indicator of the ulcer. Next complication is perforation. It occurs in 5% of the patient. Obstruction in chronic ulcers due to scarring. When it heals, scarring takes place, leading to obstruction in 2% of the patient. So the crux is, in the last slide we studied, eat healthy, stay healthy. Now we have to develop the healthy habits too. Question answer, interested? What is the common cause of developing peptic ulcer? H. pylori. Nice. H. pylori infection is the best diagnosed with? Right. Because it is a definite diagnosis, endoscopy with biopsy of the tissue. We do urease bread test also, but by endoscopy we can take the biopsy and have the definite diagnosis. We can see the bacteria in the mucus layer. What is Zollinger-Ellison syndrome? Right, gastrinoma in the pancreas or duodenum leading to formation of peptic ulcer. Possible complication of an untreated or incompletely treated peptic ulcer? Right. Perforation, infection, and scar formation. Chronic atrophic gastritis caused by H. pylori is mainly associated with increased incidence of diffuse type gastric carcinoma, intestinal type adenocarcinoma, squamous carcinoma, hepatic type, or carcinoid. Perfect. Intestinal type adenocarcinoma. So we end the class with this. No. One more question. How to prevent formation of recurrent peptic ulcer? All of the above. Getting treated for H. pylori infection, limiting alcohol and quitting smoking, seeking medical advice on the use of NSAIDs. All of the above. That was the last question. Thank you.